Welcome to the Nerd Party.
Hi, this is Henry Gilroy, co-executive producer of Star Wars Rebels. You're listening to Aggressive Negotiations.
Well, hello, and welcome to Aggressive Negotiations, the Nerd Party Network's Star Wars podcast coming at you from the ruins of Luke Skywalker's house on Tatooine. John, I've got to say, the sunsets here are gorgeous.
I'm still wondering, to be honest with you, is that place looked actually a little restored from when we last left it in Episode 4. So I would wonder, I think that there's a story opportunity here that somebody moved back in between sagas and, moved back out. I think that you can't possibly tell me that nobody lived in that place for 30 years because, look, I know it was filled with sand and everything, but I mean, a desert for 30 years, that place was, that place should have been buried.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, But we're really excited, to be here this week. We've actually got a really fun topic from an email that we got from a listener, and absolutely just love getting emails from listeners, and just want to say thank you to all of the listeners out there who subscribe to the show, have listened to the show, interact with us on social media. It really does mean a lot to John and I, and just the community that we have around the show is so much fun. And so join that community. Make sure, if this is your first time listening, subscribe to the show wherever you get your podcasts. If you've listened to this show and you happen to have access to an Apple product, give us a review on Apple Podcasts. It really does help other people find the show. And we read the reviews of every single review that gets written. So no matter what you say, we read your review on the show. You can find us on Twitter. There's the show account, The Jedi Masters. That's where everything Aggressive Negotiations and Star Wars is happening. And then we've got the entire network at Join Nerd Party that you can follow, which is a great place to be following because there's so much going on the Nerd Party. Make sure you check out thenerdparty.com. Please like us over on Facebook at facebook.com/thenerdparty. And then last but not least, just as this listener has done, John, everybody can send us emails. You can go to thenerdparty.com/contact, and then you just pick Aggressive Negotiations, and you can share your thoughts with us, and your thoughts may spur an entire episode, as this listener's email has done. And John, this one's really interesting. There's some, I would say this listener is continually sending us thought-provoking ideas.
We get thought-provoking ideas from a lot of listeners, and we appreciate all of you who, like Matt said, that send in notes. And even if there are times where we're not slowing down and like reading out specific chunks, we are consuming your email and thinking it through, and it is spurring on these topics. So in this case, we felt it was justified to read out portions of the email just because there are some more intricate aspects to it. So this is from a listener with the with the name HH, with another Star Wars theory about Anakin and Obi-Wan's parallel journeys. While acknowledging that some aspects of it have probably been discussed on the show, it happens. To start it off, the email starts, "I think the first parallel is the fact that both of these Jedi made promises. Obi-Wan promises Qui-Gon that he will train Anakin, and Anakin promises his late mother that he will never fail to save someone from death again. Both promises eventually lead to the destruction of the Jedi and the Republic, with Anakin turning his back on the Jedi, which is Obi-Wan's failure, and failing to save Padme from death, which is Anakin's failure. However, both promises are fulfilled in the future. Obi-Wan's, once Vader is Anakin Skywalker again at the end of Return of the Jedi, and Anakin's is indirectly fulfilled when his grandson saves Rey from death." And then supposing you could also say that Anakin saving Luke from the Emperor at the end of Return of the Jedi is a fulfillment of his promise to save a loved one from death, depending on your point of view. So I think this is a good jumping off point. I will say that this idea of the delayed promise of Vader coming into play with Ben Solo is an interesting one. I would side more on the side of saying that while I like this parallel, I don't think that Anakin's promise was a good one. And right. So I wouldn't necessarily want to see it fulfilled. But do you think that this still stands up, even if you take that aspect out of it?
Mm-hmm.
I still think it's an interesting parallel.
Yeah, I mean, so the idea of them both making these promises and one, you know, for Obi-Wan, it could be maybe a rash promise to promise somebody who's dying, you know, should probably never make promises to anyone or anything while you're in a heightened emotional state. And so
that is a good plan. Yes.
And, you know, whether it's marriages or whatever, it's just a good axiom to live by, folks. My own life is a testament to that, honestly. So,
hey, you could also listen to Paradise by the Dashboard Light for an example of don't make a promise during a heightened emotional state. So,
but I think, you know, the thing that's really interesting here is, I do think Anakin's promise is one that comes out of a completely wrong place, right?
Mm-hmm.
It comes from the place which Yoda obviously talks about, this idea of possession, and which is obviously a kernel of the dark side, that we would possess something so much that we wouldn't necessarily allow it to have its own life, really, that's not in our control. And to say you can control another life in that way putting yourself in the place of the Force, in place of God, right? And so what's interesting is that, you know, I wouldn't say that Obi-Wan's promise is in that same category of like wrongness. Like he's making a promise that he probably shouldn't make, but to train Anakin is quite different than like promising that you won't allow somebody you love to die, because we see, you know, that the training that Obi-Wan gives is, you know, in line with the Jedi Order, and is one that is forgiving of Anakin at times when maybe he shouldn't be, as we've talked about on the show. So I don't know if the promises are necessarily at the same level of badness, like if we were going to go on the Lilo and Stitch badness level and we were going to color in how much badness there is, you know, like I don't know if Obi-Wan's is quite as high as Anakin's there.
Okay, first and foremost, spoiler warning, because I've never seen Lilo and Stitch, although with this wonderful Disney Plus app that they hooked me with.
I didn't really spoil anything for you, so.
I know, I was just, you know me. I love to throw the random spoiler warnings out there just as a joke, like, you know, when I'll say, you know, you know that Vader, you know, is Luke's father, I'll say spoiler warning just because, why not?
Just in case, okay. 30 years later.
But this is the thing, right, is I'm not disputing that Obi-Wan and Anakin's promises are at the same level of bad idea. You
right.
know, that there is a, you know, like you said, there's a scale of bad.
I've made a huge mistake, Michael.
Yeah, exactly. But I would say that Obi-Wan's insistence to train Anakin, to your point, yes, comes during a heightened emotional state. But also I think that there is a touch of pride about it. Pride that he learned from Qui-Gon, because
right.
he's saying that even if the council doesn't give me permission, I'm going to train him anyway. He is throwing aside, in that moment, he's saying, I'm good enough to do this. You can't tell me no. And in a sense, that's very much in the same vein of pride as Anakin saying, mm-hmm. you know, basically to the universe itself, you can't tell me that I can't save somebody.
Right.
And so they're definitely in the same family.
Yes. And I do think, I mean, that's what makes it so interesting when Obi-Wan says, you know, I thought I could train him as well as Yoda. I was wrong. And that's the beauty of at least that part of the story, too. You see that redemption in Obi-Wan admitting his wrongness mm-hmm. to Luke, and also, you know, trying to use that example as a way to then teach the next generation.
And, you know, it's something that occurs to me while we're talking about this, is that Obi-Wan technically dies with his sin still on his head, right? Yet achieves that, you know, sainthood status. We know he's gone to heaven, sort of thing. And one of the big problems that everybody
all had, Jedi go to heaven.
Yeah, basically.
It's a new Disney movie.
Yeah. Hey, if you fade, it means, right? But there is see, now you got me thinking of, you know, all Jedi go to heaven, and I'm starting to cast it and like see what animation style it would be in, and that's terrible. You've done that to me. But that for me is interesting, because with Obi-Wan dying with his sin on his head and still being able to achieve that next level, one of the things people have thrown a challenge flag on is that Anakin shows up at the end of Return of the Jedi. For some reason, nobody had a problem with this until they saw Hayden Christensen. Then everybody had a philosophical problem with, you know, Anakin's Force ghost coming back. But I think that's an interesting parallel as well, that like the we know that the criteria, it's not, you know, you don't come back as a Force ghost just because of the purity level that you die at, sort of thing. It's a, you know, a talent that you learn, sort of thing. But Anakin redeems himself, but still has, I guess you could say, a lot of, you know, stain on his soul. Obi-Wan has at least that little smudge on his soul. I think that's interesting too, that they both sort of, you know, go out in a place of disputable grace, if you will, but we still see them attain that next level. This idea that, you know, that forgiveness can happen, you know, in that moment or in that, you know, transitional stage or something like that, because Obi-Wan obviously, you know, came to peace with it or something. And, you know, even if it was in the time, let's say he was in Jedi purgatory for the years between Star Wars and Empire, right?
Really?
Maybe he was. Who knows? No, but like you see what I'm going
yeah.
with, right?
Yeah.
I think that as we're talking about this, I'm thinking just in terms of the fact that everybody sort of gives Obi-Wan a pass, but a state of grace, if you will, isn't necessarily our criteria. And that then I think skips forward to the problem that some people have voiced about Ben Solo fading and presumably being able to go on to that next level at the end of Rise of Skywalker. What do you think about that? Do you think that Obi-Wan could be sort of our salve here, where we can see that you don't have to be a perfect person to,
right,
you know do that?
Well, and I think that's absolutely a good way to look at it, because look, the idea that you have to acquire perfection to be forgiven, you know, and to be able to pass on into the Jedi afterlife, you know, obviously Qui-Gon hadn't, right? Yoda hadn't. Yoda still had the stain of the failure of the entire Jedi Order on him, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And he is still able to so I think there's the beauty in that the goal here for the Jedi is, and this is, I think, maybe where the key comes in. It is to pass on what you have learned, and mm-hmm. even your failures, to reference The Last Jedi. That is one thing that both Obi-Wan and Yoda both do, right? Whether mm-hmm. Luke learns those lessons from those failures is entirely up to what Luke chooses to do. But both Yoda and Obi-Wan have definitely learned lessons, and as we've talked about many times, one of the ways in which, you know, they train Luke and many of the precautions they take with him have to do with the lessons that they learned from training Anakin, and some of their fears as to who Luke himself might turn out to be.
And the thing is, so long as we're still talking about this, it is interesting as well that Leia does not, you know, disappear / become one with the Force until Ben goes. So that's an interesting sort of philosophical thing to go with as well, because, you know, we accept Vader goes on, pretty much right there, at least, you know, because this, you know, is he burning the body? Is he burning the armor? That sort of thing at the end of Return of the Jedi. But by the time of the Ewok celebration, Anakin has transitioned, but Leia hangs around. So I think there's an interesting thing about the connection there, and how that plays into the sort of thing.
So a couple things. One, it does seem that, and this is just my own personal headcanon, so, you know, and that's what we do as fans when we don't have something specifically explained, but is that those in the Force that have done acts of extreme sacrifice can be given the gift of Jedi immortality if the Force deems it applicable, you know. And so that's how I've always taken Anakin's, return. And it's how I take Ben's return there as well. Although, you know, Ben was trained by Luke before he turned to the dark side. This could also be something that Ben, that Luke had begun to train him in. So, I mean, that's not that unusual to think of, honestly. But Leia not actually transitioning until her son dies, I truly believe that's because there is a spiritual connection between her and her son the moment she kind of gives up her Force energy, and then the moment that he transitions that all the way to, and he gives that up completely to another, they can both, you know, go on to the, to, you know, the beyond, to the Force. And which was kind of a, you know, it's a really beautiful moment because spiritually and metaphysically and honestly physically, because the Force has a physical manifestation with the midichlorians, Rey is a Skywalker. So when she says that, it is not just like her just making the choice, but she's legitimately a Skywalker now.
Because that energy has been...
Yeah. Yeah.
That blessing, if you will, has been transferred
spiritually
to her.
And physically, she is that character now. So I just, you know, I think that's really interesting, you know. And again, what I think is kind of beautiful is that I saw this question on Facebook today, but, you know, what is the overarching message of the entire Star Wars saga? And to me, in light of what we get in The Rise of Skywalker, it specifically comes down to that idea of George's simple idea. This is a story between the selfish life and the selfless life. And that's it. There's the binary. You either live a selfless life or you live a selfish life. And what is the repercussions of both of those? And The Rise of Skywalker seems to be completely on the side of the Jedi and, of course, the selfless life. And, you know, I think there's a... To me, it's one of those cohesive units, which I think is beautiful about the entire thing now. And one of the ways I think that it does hold cohesion as a 9-part saga.
Yeah, we'll table the thought that I had there, because I think we'd be doing HH, you know, short shrift if we didn't.
Yeah, write it down, put a pin in it, and we'll come back at another show.
Yeah, the second parallel that HH wanted to point out was the fact that both Anakin and Obi-Wan had a fated love, because Satine was selfless enough not to ask Obi-Wan to stay, and Obi-Wan was so committed to the Jedi Order that he wouldn't leave unless Satine asked him. On the other hand, Anakin and Padme were impulsive and chose to marry despite the damage their marriage could do to each other, revealing Anakin's tendency towards selfishness. So, and minor spoilers, if you haven't gotten through the Clone Wars, your Clone Wars rewatch or watch for the first time or whatever, when Satine died, Obi-Wan let her and his anger go, while Anakin's love for Padme became more about his inability to live without her, leading him to destroy innocent lives, only for him to despise her once he suspected she'd been unfaithful. As the son tells Anakin on Mortis, his love is not even love anymore. It is a prison. I think that's interesting. I think that's very interesting, because the I guess, somewhat dangerous conversational lens that I see this through is that it reveals that your own decisions are your own decisions. They're very important. You have to be thoughtful. You can't be impulsive, or, you know, if you're impulsive and selfish, it leads to, you know, decisions you shouldn't make. But there's also an interesting aspect here, and I don't know if it's intentional or not for HH to have this in there, but the way I'm seeing it is Obi-Wan fell in love with the right person, and possibly Anakin fell in love with the wrong person. Because I think that there's a, and I'm this is strictly my own thought that's coming out of having just read that section. Is it possible, and I think we've touched on this before, but I want to take a look at it. Is it possible that Padme is given a little bit too much of a pass for her own part in what was to become, you know, a very bad relationship to get into? You know, that doesn't,
right.
I hope to heaven that nobody takes that as saying, like, are you saying it's okay what Anakin did? Of course not. But I'm saying, like, that decision right there, Anakin can't get married to himself. And Padme knows it's a bad idea. So isn't there, you know, like, Satine didn't ask Obi-Wan to do it, and Padme went along with it. You know, like, I think that's an interesting flip there.
So as you're talking, I was thinking about this idea, and, you know, you think back to episode 2, and Anakin seems to have kind of given up on the, not given up on the idea, but he's put to rest the idea that him and Padme are going to be together.
Yeah.
And then Padme confesses her love for him before they're going to die, she thinks.
Yeah.
And that leads them to continue to walk down that path. And so I do think she is responsible for her choice in that of continuing to open up this can of worms that will lead them down the path to make this decision towards this selfish relationship, regardless of what it will do to one another. And I think that HH is really keyed in on something that we don't really talk about a lot, but both Padme and Anakin choose willingly to enter a relationship to which they know to be wrong, which mm-hmm. they know to be not good for either of them, whether it's their careers as they've chosen or just each other, because mm-hmm. they are living a lie, and that lie is going to eat them alive. Whereas, as you mentioned, you know, you get this beauty of Obi-Wan and Satine, who truly love each other in a way that is what true love is, right?
Mm-hmm.
That they do not compromise one another, that they do not make the other go against their values and everything that they are, because by doing that, they would fundamentally change that which they loved in a way that would probably hurt the love that they supposedly have for one another. And so I think HH is really keyed into something here with her reading there, and I really like that. One of the things that it does go on there, and I wanted to touch on this because there was, I don't know if I agree with this part, but HH said, despite the differences, Obi-Wan and Anakin's love does become faded. If not destructive, Obi-Wan's love for Satine is partially responsible for Maul's targeting Mandalore, which Obi-Wan's decision to return to Mandalore to save Satine, leading not only to Satine's death, but also leading to the Republic invasion. Because the Republic would soon become the Empire, the decision indirectly caused Mandalore to be destroyed in the Night of a Thousand Tears. And Anakin's love, well, we all know what happened there. I do really take issue with this idea that it's Obi-Wan's fault indirectly, because before he even... Maul is on Mandalore for his own purposes that have nothing to do with Satine. Mm-hmm. mean, he's there because he's creating a criminal underworld, and he's using you know, Death Watch to help him do that. It just happens to be a byproduct that's a moment of glee for him that he can also cause pain to Obi-Wan by finding out that Satine and Obi-Wan have this relationship. But the main cause for him being on Mandalore has nothing to do with that. That just is something that comes out, you know, and then the reason that Mandalore gets into so much trouble is not because of Obi-Wan and Satine. It happens because Darth Sidious comes and puts the smackdown on Maul and then uses it as to his advantage to come in and take over Mandalore with the Republic. Again, that has nothing to do, I don't think, with Obi-Wan and Satine. They're kind of minor players in what is a larger political machination happening between Maul and Darth Sidious, really, at that point.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I agree with you there, and it ties into or leads into H.H.'s third antithetic parallelism. And just to sum it up, what's interesting is that Obi-Wan gives up his chance at a family and life for Satine, but winds up being the one sort of becoming Luke's father, even from a distance, before that moment when he saves him from the Tusken Raiders. So in a sense, Obi-Wan, though distant, gets to have sort of that family experience that Anakin always wanted. So I think that's an interesting thing to hook onto. It's obviously not perfect because Obi-Wan, you know, did keep his distance. If you subscribe to any part of the lore that hasn't been directly overwritten yet, there's the story that everybody loves to, you know, recount that, and this goes all the way back to the radio drama when they first aired that, where you find out there was a story where Luke was in danger in the desert, Obi-Wan saved him, and then Owen chased Ben off and was like, don't come back here again. And, you know, so Obi-Wan at the very least had some sort of familial experience with Luke. And I think that winds up going with another interesting parallel in that Anakin's pursuit to save Padme from death, to learn to conquer death. I mean, it's not really about Padme. It's his own personal quest, really. Like, the Sith are all focused over here, and the Jedi figure out the path to retaining their identity after death. And I think that this Obi-Wan getting a familial experience that Anakin winds up robbing himself of, I think that's an interesting double parallel there, like a, you know, sort of like inversion, a reversal of expectation, if you will.
Yeah, and I think it's honestly really interesting too, because when you think about it, you know, Anakin did have that opportunity to have a somewhat familiar relationship with Ahsoka, right? You know, I mean, mm-hmm. A Padawan is kind of like your kid. And being a master is all about training up that Padawan in the way they should go, and hopefully when they're old, they don't depart from it. You know, that's the point. But it's also about letting them, being able to let them go and make their own mistakes and becoming their own person. And, you know, we see Anakin do that not so great with Ahsoka in many ways. And it's interesting, like, this idea of Obi-Wan getting family, because in many ways I think obviously Obi-Wan sees Anakin is family in a lot of ways. Maybe they're closer than they should be as master and apprentice. You know, there's maybe too much of a bond there, but you also see a very familiar relationship between, you know, Anakin. I mean, you also see a very familiar relationship between Obi-Wan and helping to train when he's around Ahsoka, train her.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like you said, I think this is really interesting, this idea that, you know, he gets to be the far-off uncle to Luke.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, you do kind of see this antithetical parallelism between these two of because Anakin was trying to hold on to things so much, it brings to mind, you know, I can't think of any other way to put this, but the Bible verse, you know, he who tries to gain his life will lose it, you know, and he who loses his life will find it. So, Obi-Wan's willing to be self-sacrificial and give up his life, and he gets a life, whereas Anakin's holding onto his life, and he loses it, really.
Well, as much as, you can also point to, you know, if the more you tighten your grip, Tarkin, star systems will exactly. slip through your fingers. You know, the more you try to hold on, the more it goes through like sand through your fingers. But jumping to, I think, a very interesting wrap up that HH has in the email, I'll go ahead and read here. I think Obi-Wan and Anakin might be a reversal of Ben and Rey's forced dyad in The Rise of Skywalker. Obi-Wan and Anakin began as a pair in balance, with Obi-Wan's order acting as a balance to Anakin's chaos, but their differing natures pulled them apart. Now, I think this is very interesting because, you know, HH then touches on the fact that, you know, Ben and Rey's dyad pulls them together. Obi-Wan and Anakin wind up, you know, pushing each other apart. But the only reason I'm going to discount it is because the dyad, as explained on screen, according to Palpatine, has not happened in generations, which I dislike because I would have liked it to have been Luke and Leia to be the previous dyad, because that would have made some sort of sense, because they were continually drawn together. They, you know, shared a unique bond in the Force, those sorts of things. But, you know, hasn't happened in generations. But I don't think, while Anakin and Obi-Wan were very closely bonded, especially by their experiences and their time together, Ben and Rey were connected in such a way that you could argue that even if Rey had never gotten off of Jakku, mm-hmm. that Ben and she would have crossed paths somehow. They would have had to. If they're a dyad, they truly would have had to cross right. paths. I mean, as it is, it seems to have been activated by Rey grabbing Anakin's saber. That seems to have triggered the connection to go into high gear or what have you. What's your take on that? Do you think, obviously, I'm not down with the idea of Obi-Wan and Anakin as, you know, being in that sort of vein, but what's your take on it?
I think it's definitely an interesting idea. And this is where I could kind of see it as the fact that the Jedi themselves had created this mode of operation, which is to remove themselves a little bit, maybe too much, from things and not allow true feeling to be there, and being, and I think in many ways, kind of afraid of love. Like they're kind of afraid of what it means to truly love. And then that's the thing that truly brought, you know, Rey and Ben together, was this love that they have, and that love allows her to reach Ben in a way that he can understand and helps bring him back. You know, when she says, "I wanted to take your hand, but I wanted to take Ben's hand," you know, she's pointing out the fact that I love you, but I don't love the evil part of you. I don't love this evil that you're choosing. What I love is the person that I know that you can be. And in many ways, I think it's that opening themselves up to love in all of its fullness that the Jedi had not had, and maybe that would have been a way in which, you know, Anakin and Obi-Wan, if there had been a truer form of love there, one that was not kind of stamped down, that maybe Obi-Wan could have reached Anakin in a way that would have made more sense to Anakin, because he would have felt the love that he needed. And sometimes that means, you know, being able to have the very tough love that somebody needs. Mm-hmm. And so it's an interesting thing. I honestly wouldn't say that Anakin and Obi-Wan are a reverse dyad, just because of like what you said on screen. But I just think that when we're talking about all of these parallels that we see, it is really interesting. And I think there's a lot of validity to so much of what HH has said, and just, you know, thinking through this idea. And I think what it shows me is, you know, we've talked about this over the last few weeks as we've kind of dove in and out of ideas from The Rise of Skywalker, and that the movie has given us a lot to talk about, you know, mm-hmm. and a lot of stuff that does have parallels and like ideas that rhyme and have rhythm with, you know, what came before. And I think that's one of the things that I've appreciated about it, because it's great. You know, that's what we love about Star Wars. And so being able to talk about these things and have discussions about these things, even though, you know, both you and I have differing opinions on the movie overall, I just think that that's really cool. And it's one of those things that makes me really excited, you know, to be able to continue that, because, you know, as this email is proof of, you know, we can go down some really fun, crazy rabbit holes. So that's exciting to me, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's exciting to me too. It's to borrow a line about Shakespeare, Star Wars is like pizza. Even when it's not great, it's still good. And when it's good, yeah, man, it's great. You know?
Yeah.
So that's just a line that a Shakespeare professor used with me one time. So
yeah, great email though. And I mean, this is the kind of thing that we just love, is being able to get into this kind of minutia about Star Wars. But again, I just, you know, it's just fun that we can have these type of conversations.
Yes, it is.
Listeners. And so thank you so much for your email. Keep all those emails coming, because again, even if we don't read your email out, as we mentioned just a couple weeks ago, you know, our show was spurred on by emails that we've gotten in the past, and we've been thinking about, ruminating about, and once the movie finally came out, we could kind of spill our guts on where we, you know, ended up with some of those ideas. So we really appreciate everybody reaching out, because it makes it a lot of fun.
It does. You guys are our Jedi text.
But John, maybe somebody else wants to spur on another show with an idea that they have. Where could they find you if they wanted to do that?
Oh, shucks. Right now, you can find me lurking around online as Kessel Junkie, KESSELJUNKIE. And I'm a little bit between projects outside of aggressive negotiations right now. However, there is a top secret thing coming on the Nerd Party that I'll tip you all off when it's coming. So, but that's where you can find me. Matt, where are the myriad places where they can get in contact with you or share thoughts with you about other topics?
Well, you can find me on Twitter, Instagram, Letterboxd, Vero, under the name MattRushing02. I am here on the network doing Owlpost with Drea Kaufman, and we talk about Harry Potter each and every week, one chapter at a time. And of course, I know my esteemed colleague here will be listening to that fervently as he rereads the Harry Potter series for the first time in quite a while. So cannot wait to hear his updates. You can also find me over on the Track FM network. I do two shows there. One's called The Orb, doing that with Chris Jones. And when we get a chance to record, we talk about Star Trek Deep Space Nine, which is the best Star Trek show out there. You can find me doing the General Geek Show called The 602 Club. I do that with my friend Christy Morris and other friends who drop by, and we talk about all the fandoms we love. In fact, I'll give you a hint. You may hear John Mills there in a couple weeks as we talk through the entire first season of The Mandalorian. And last but not least, you can find me doing Cinema Stories with my good friend Courtney, where we talk about films, the ones of faith. And we just recently talked about all of the thematic elements from The Rise of Skywalker ourselves. So check all those out. But John, I'm exhausted after that list, and I hear the chimes at midnight as they're calling us to sleep there at the temple. I think it's time to head back and close these negotiations.
Parting is such sweet sorrow. Negotiations are closed.
Join the revolution. Join the Nerd Party.